but then, it's a later been reviewed by Senator, who is actually a senior research associate in the program. He's doing a lot of work on food, diet, cleanliness, almost actually created the water cleanliness program. After Sean Thompson, all the students started it. And he's also pursuing a PhD degree, so he's going to talk about UAVs and how long you go see UAV techniques in helping with the forest program, because a lot of the weeds and the soil that is growing in Texas is great. And so I'll give it to Brian. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. My name is Brian Simina. I'll just be presenting a portion of my research work, small grain forest biomass analysis using UAV technology. You see all the different organizations involved. I mean, it's quite an undertaking nowadays with UAV and remote sensing. So let's talk a little bit about the importance of, forage biomass prediction. Forage biomass in pastures is one of the major determinant factors of the carrying capacity and performance of grazing animals. So it's really important to know how much forage you have for these animals. You don't want to overstock. In this picture on the left, you see these cows. They're very happy. They're not even worried about eating that much. They're all looking at the camera man. They're standing meat even oats. So that's a good place to. The ones on the right here are being hay fed, and they look a little more stressed than that. Just my opinion on those two. So I borrowed this from one of Dr. Redden's publications. This kind of sums up the whole thing with that. And that grazing animal should receive most, if not all, of their nutrition from forages that are standing in the field. Any deviation from this strategy can result in reduced profit potential due to, generally higher cost of hay and reduced animal performance. So it's kind of important, and it's something we need to kind of look into. Now let's get into the UAV portion of it. Agricultural drones are relatively cheap drones with advanced sensors, and it can help producers, increase yield and also reduce crop damage. This picture, the lower right, is it's an older model, but it's one of the platforms and sensors used by the cannabis program here on campus. I don't think they use this one anymore, but it's just kind of an example. And with that, you'll get like generally a four-band sensor. You'll have a kind of showing this slide here. You'll get your blue, your green, your red, and your near infrared. As you can see from the reflectance here, most of your vegetation has a high reflectance in the NIR band, and that's just outside of the realm of visual light. Now, with that being said, with those four bands, you can get a number of different indices. Now, the one we commonly use in agriculture for these types of purposes is the NDVI, which is the Normalized Difference Vegetation Index. And that's calculated by looking at the NIR band and the red band. Now, with that, you can get this NDVI number. So for a healthy vegetation, usually you'll get like a higher number, like a 0.72. As far as stressed vegetation, you'll get like a 0.14. So kind of gives you an idea of scale there. And like I mentioned, there's other indices like this GDVI, which was used for predicting nitrogen requirements of the corn. That's just using the NIR band and the green band. And you've got this GNDVI, and then there's another popular one is the LALI. There's several of them out there. Now, challenges in conducting forest trials, which we all know, I mean, our group knows quite well, but extensive data collection and analysis can be time-consuming and labor-intensive. Now, if you look here, gathering data by hand, I've done that. I've been out there. It's hot. Then it over your back 30. But you do that enough, and then you look at this picture on the right, on the left, and you know, you got your nice little UAV flying over a field, collect the data for it. So it's just a little bit cooler and easier way to collect data. Now, note taking can be subjective. Visual ratings, everyone's got a different eye for orbs and things like that. Plot establishment, also, you know, seeing how cool the plots are. Everyone can have a different take on that. And even height data, you know, when you're going through the field, if you're not getting eye level with that crop and that measuring stick, then you're not getting a real accurate measurement across.
That is an old beast. That takes us out of our experiment session.
That one's been outdated for a little while. But, oh, I wanted to show this other. This here is our handheld NUVI sensor. It just gives you, you kind of walk along the plot, and it gives you an average reading of that plot. So, as far as NUVI looks like. Also, plot harvesting equipment can have breakdowns, you can have operator errors, not making any cuts, scales can get affected by wind. Here's our dinosaur that we're using now. It's seen better days, but it does get the job done for us so far. But, every time we go out and make cuts in that field, I'm praying it makes it through. Because I've had issues where it didn't. Also, here you can see this is the bin where the forage is kept. So once it goes through, the load cells are down here at the bottom, but this is open. So when you get a real windy day, that wind's kind of rolling around in there, and you're waiting for the scale to zero out. So sometimes it can take a really long time to get that done. Benefits of forage biomass prediction. The research for breeders go, you know. Ability to screen thousands of lines for forage potential as opposed to being limited to only a few. I know working with oats, you know, that's the primary purpose for oats in Texas is for grazing. So but when you're only limited to, you know, four or five spots in the forage trial, you know, it kind of ties your hands a little bit. It's almost a guessing game there. You know, you had to sacrifice them. So if you're able to get out there and fly these plots and look at who may have the highest force potential, then it'll give you a better idea which lines you can have. Now, as far as extension goes, these guys usually conduct these trials. It's very labor intensive. That's probably the most limiting factor on the forage trial side. And the cost of the forage harvester far outweighs that of the UAV system. I think a new forage harvester is about $160,000. Compared to a UAV system, probably $5,000. And with producers, you could they could assist in implementing these forage systems and grazing cycles. So let's look back at last year. This is last year's forage trial here in the Brazos Bottom. Now we have nine different classes of even some blends in there. We have oat ryegrass, cereal rye, and some wheat. And with those, you know, several different entries, it's not really uniform, so we're going to have five of each class. You know, it's just kind of whatever we're able to get in there, whatever has the most interest. There's just some pictures of those. You got winter wheat, winter oat, trick, hay, cereal rye, winter barley, rye. And this is kind of an overall view of the forage trial last year. It's a randomized complete plot design. We've got 40 entries, 4 reps. So the objective, determine the phenotypic performance of cool season grasses in terms of above ground biomass yield, the primary trait, the lower variables. So this is just kind of the field portion. So this is getting the NDVI handheld, this is taking height notes, looking at visual ratings and plot steps and things like that. The next objective would be to determine if these UAV data can accurately measure relative differences remotely in acoustics and grasses for above ground biomass. So that's looking at the UAVs in there, NDVI and things like that. And lastly, to develop a model to predict above ground biomass yield based on UAV multispectral images and estimate prediction accuracy between actual and predicted yield. So with that, this is the field data from one clipping last year. We had 5 clippings total, and so this is just one that we had kind of gotten through. So you've got your entry and variety. We got wet weight, dry weight of a subsample. We got the percent dry matter based off of that. We have a field NDVI, a Sigma LL handheld meter. We got our yield. That's the whole plot yield, and ranking based on that yield. Visual ratings that I took as I was walking through, and plant height. So some of the correlations, this is a field data correlation for all the crops. So as you see, field NDVI and yield have pretty good correlation with each other. Also visual rating and yield was pretty good. And height wasn't as good for all crops, but we'll get into that a little bit here. So then we broke it down by species. So we're looking at winter wheat. So field NDVI and yield, again, was pretty good. The visual rating and yield was also good. It had improved with the height and yield. I think it's a lot to do with the nature of wheat to grow more upright, so you get more of that biomass up higher. And for oats, the same thing with the field NDVI was about 0.85 in yield. And visual rating, the yield was really good. Well, that's, look at oats all day long, so I could pretty much have a good eye for that, but that's not typical. You're not usually going to get that. But the height, now, did not have as good a correlation. And, the yield with oats, they tend to grow more outward. So that kind of explains that a little bit. I was looking at ryegrass, yield and field NDVI was really good. Visual rating also was pretty good, and the height was a little better than that of oats.
NDVI is not.
What's that?
NDVI is not the measure.
The measure what?
It's not the measure.
No, it's not. It's just that reflective. So, once they fly the field, this is just into the UAV portion. So once they fly the field, they take hundreds, maybe 1,000 images, right? And they'll mosaic those together. The guys at GeoSat do that for us. So this is our overhead view of our field right here. This is kind of a zoomed in portion of it. We're just concerned with this little rectangle here. And all these little polygons were drawn in by hand using the NV software. So I drew all these in, and that's just covering each plot. So we call those reorientations. Now the colors really don't represent anything, it's just showing you different plots. So it's not like intensity or anything like that. And once you get your regions of interest drawn, you can get data from that. So this is the regions of interest laid over a NDVI map. So basically, the bands are calculated on that map below, and you overlay your regions of interest that were drawn there. With that information, so for plot 440 here, you can see it right there. You get that mean number, and that mean is the mean for that entire plot. So for that entire region of interest of plot 440, it's the NDVI reflectance would be 0.59. Now, also, we have other bands. We've got the red, the green, and the blue. So, with that, here you have the 4 bands shown, and then you have your mean reflectance for those individually. So, you have NIR, red, green, blue. And you can do the same, you can get the same kind of information, or just get for each part, reflect the slopes. Now, here's our UAV, NDVI and multispectral data results. So, again, you have plot and variety. The UAV NDVI rating, that was assumed. You have the reflectance numbers for each band, and also added the field NDVI and geo that bands over there. So the correlations for those, this is the UAV data of all crops with NDVI and multispectral. So, you know, the first one, you're looking at NDVI, the UAV NDVI, and the field NDVI had a really good correlation, so they at least were accurate on either ground or air. You know. And the yield was pretty good on that one. And also for band one alone, without even having the formula for NDVI, had pretty good correlation with yield. And the field also about the same. And this is for wheat. So we've got, again, the field and the UAV and the UDI were communicating pretty well on that one. The yield was 0.8, so that was pretty good. And the band one was not as good, 0.22. But that's for wheat. Then you get into oats here, yield again 0.76, not really bad, which you had improved with just band 1, just looking at band 1, at 0.74. And this is rye bass, so this one was a little more interesting, you know, again we had a really good correlation with the two different instruments we used to measure NDVI, and we've got yield was 0.7, but if you look at the band 1 alone, just the NIR band, it was 0.74. But I mean, ryegrass, if you stand out there and look at it, you can tell it's really green, it's really bright, stuff like that. So that may be something we can look at later on, how we could maybe come up with a different index for that or something. Now, to sum that portion up, there's very good correlation between field NDI and visual ratings when compared to yield. Plant height did not correlate as well to yield when compared to other variables. There's good correlation between field NDVI and UAV NDVI, especially looking at ryegrass. There was good correlation between yield when compared to both field NDVI and UAV NDVI across all crops, with the exception of ryegrass, which that NIR band was slightly higher. Now, ongoing work, to continue processing that year's data, last year's data. I probably should have been done with that by now, but I do work for it. Look at the data from the other bands to determine if a combination of different bands can be used as biomass predictors. Repeat trial for this year and begin work on objective 3, pretty good model for predicting yield. Based on UAV data alone, and determine if it works for all species and equipment. Now, this last portion was kind of added recently. We had a problem with getting data this year. We had scheduled some flights with the same sensor and camera, or platform and sensor, but that didn't work out for us. So luckily, Dr. Papescu's group from ESSM were willing to help us out and give us some flights and some LIDAR scans and things like that. So we're going to look at this year and maybe determine if LIDAR data could be used to obtain above ground biomass.
There we go.
So this is gives you kind of an overview of the two. This is a rotary UAV with a sensor on the bottom, and this guy's flying it over, you know, a wheat field. And up in the left side here, you've got the right side. This is the your LIDAR scanner. And this is kind of an example of an image you can get from. It's more of a model. get that from the LIDARs, the terrestrial LIDAR. So here's our first flight. This was done with this little rotary UAV, and it's just got a, it only has an RGB sensor there, so it doesn't have the capability to give us NIR as well. But we've got this image, and then we've got a second one that they're kind of working on still for us. And when we do these flights, we have to get ground control points. And these tiles here are set on the four corners and one in the middle. And we go out and do the GPS. And that way that gives them a reference to mosaic these images together. Now here's again the first flight, and I drew those ROIs over the plots again for the regions of interest. And here's the data we got from that. Again, you know, much of the same data. We have the forage rating, the height, the plot establishment. This is a handheld NDDI. And then we've got yield and just the RGB. See if we can do with all this information. Now, the objectives of this portion of the study would be determine the capabilities of LIDAR and or structure from motion to generate point cloud data to obtain three-dimensional structures of above-ground biomass, plots and inclusions and forage. That's just basically seeing if we can get a nice 3D canopy of a wheat, you know, a forage crop. And determine if the volume of above ground biomass plot obtained from point cloud data could relate back to plot yield. So point clouds are basically just a set of data points in some coordinate system, and in a three-dimensional coordinate system, these are like X, Y, and Z. So, and they usually represent the external surface of an object. So as you can see, I added this light bulb because that was done with a LIDAR scan, but it shows kind of the details you can get from these scanners. And then this other image on the right here is buildings, and you can see the height is more related to the color. So you have the red would be the tallest, and then you go orange and yellow, green. But really detailed images you can get from that. So structure for motion is, there's basically two techniques for getting point cloud data, and structure for motion is one, and it's a technique used for estimating three-dimensional structures from two-dimensional image. So basically, you just take photos from different angles of a fixed object, and you can get a three-dimensional point cloud from that. So this kind of, this little model down here illustrates those, you know, you're getting from different angles. And so this is a flight they did last year. This is kind of part of a project they were working on. But this is our forage trial. And this is obtained from that structure for motion point cloud system. And you see it has a pretty nice three-dimensional, you know, look to it from, I can make out plots from it. But that was really neat. And there's another example of LIDAR scans used in agriculture. Some corn here with, again, the heights are represented. The taller ones are in red, and you've got the orange, the yellow, the green, and so on. Another image here is a wheat field. That was done with the airborne LIDAR. So here's our forage trial. And this is part of Dr. Capestio's group. And this is our first LIDAR scan. So as you can see, you have the LIDAR instrument there. And this is kind of what you want to do to get a good scan, is have from three different angles, you know, in this case. So what we did was we got a scan from here, then one in the middle field, and one over there in that far corner. And they set up these, I call them targets. They told me not to call them targets, but they're not targets. But they're reference points. So these are like last loads, just about. So we put GPS points in all these reference points, or all these reference targets, and did the same. So that's kind of, we're still processing that data. So what I was thinking on this, I did a little research on some of the, you know, publications out there, and this came straight from the ArcMap, ArcGIS website, estimating forest canopy density and height. And, basically, you know, forest canopy density and height are used as variables in many environmental applications. You know, this is what they caught my eye, such as biomass estimation, vegetation cover, and biodiversity determination. So the canopy density is the ratio of vegetation to ground view from the air. And then canopy height, of course, is measures how far above the ground the top of the canopy is. So let's kind of get into that here a little bit. So calculating the height, you know, basically you want to get the, you know, the digital surface model, which gets the surface to include all the canopy. And then you'll have the digital elevation model, which just gets the ground level, right? With that, you can determine canopy height model. So here's some software they use. I forget the name of it, but basically it has the, you know, it has the surface model here. This they call it a train model, which is the same as the elevation model. And then here's just another example of calculating height using LIDAR. So LIDAR can be used to calculate density and height of vegetation. And this just shows, again, what I was explaining with the colors, how it's, you know, the I think the orange is the tallest and it goes down to really low would be the blue. So expected results. What we hope to get is, like I said, determine that, but get that 3D canopy structure and from the point cloud data. Now we've got two of the rotary UAV flights, and one LIDAR scan has been done, and we hope to get at least one more this year, maybe two, depending on how fast the forest goes. And we'd like to determine plot volume by isolating a plot and field and calculating its volume by the use of these point cloud data. There's, like, acknowledge my chairs, of course, Dr. Ibrahim, Dr. Neely, committee, Dr. Jean, Dr. Popescu, Dr. Rinchi, staff member Daniel, and Gigi, and Malumbo, really been a big help for doing this LIDAR stuff. Graduate students, Brandon, Sarah, Asam, Smith, Dan, Tony, and Dr. Popescu's lab. He's no longer here with us, but so LIDAR. Alright, any questions?
What's your plot size?
The plot size is 5 by 20.
Does it make a difference if you reduce the plot size of the rest of the reading?
For doing which portion of the
LIDAR? The portion that you have in the E. Oh. Have a smaller plot size.
I don't know. We haven't really tried that. We could have because that would be a little less weight, of course.
Also, the UAV does take only one reading, or it takes multiple readings, it takes a mean of this?
Yeah, I mean, they'll just do one flight, right? But they'll get the four band image. But with that, we have to use the software to go in and calculate the NDVI. So we'll just say, I want you to multiply, you know, or add band 1 to band 2 divided by the difference of band 1 and band
2. With
only one reading. Only one reading, right.
But as you find out, where you're taking multiple images at the same spot.
Right.
You're actually having an average of multiple images, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's...
Are you just taking one image?
Well, it's one image, but... It's one image, but it's mosaic together, right?
And there's overlap.
So there's overlap, some overlap, yes.
So you're creating, generally you're creating one.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Can you look at all the variables simultaneously for you? And how they all look at the same?
Yeah, that's on the step. That's coming up because I need to get through these other clippings. It's a lot of data. And I'm there on me about getting this done, and I got to talk to the boss, so I still got a job. So I'm working on getting through that data, and once I do, I'd like to, you know, maybe do a lot of the analysis of different clippings versus different species, you know. I'd like to look at it all.
Can you tell us why you take multiple clippings?
Well,
I mean, to simulate the real thing.
Right, I mean, you're simulating grazing. So you're not always going to have that. I mean, if you just did one clipping toward the end and you cut that growing mode, it's not going to grow back.
Yeah.
So you do a clipping when it gets about a foot tall or 2 foot tall, you know. Sure. That way you can kind of keep that growing point, you know, repressed, and then you keep getting more forage.
So basically, a lot of feed in Texas and Oklahoma is grazed early in the season, in the fall.
Mm-hmm.
And then they take the animal out before animal grazing starts. But once it starts, you can come back.
They won't come back.
So, you know, we have the ability to come back from the growing points. And so it can be grazed early in the season, but also led to elongate and produce grain without affecting grain yield.
Right.
But that is, you know, that's very with that regard. Some that actually result from grazing very well, some that do not. And anything that is released for a dual check of our cropping system has to have the ability to recover from grazing.
Yeah, and that's what doing these five clippings a year, you could also look at the dual purpose aspect of it. You'll get the yield at the end.
What about the forest plot? How many locations do you have in the state?
We've got three right now.
Okay.
We've got College Station, Comanche, and I think there's one up in Bushland. But Bushland's limited on what species they put up there. So we don't really send oats up there. I've got a few that are really winter tall, but normally they die out. Normally they die out in any springtime. Yes.
You're going to have a noise in your NGBI based on nature. That'll give you a heart. I guess if you take that note and see if you have it.
You're talking about like leaf angle?
Leaf angle.
Yeah. You know, I haven't looked at that. I know the overall idea of business NGBI is not like looking at a single plant. It's looking at, I mean, I would say it's even plot capacity. Because you're averaging, as you're doing that average over that whole plot, you're taking the ground into consideration, which gives you a really low reading. You're taking vegetation and you have more ground. So it's kind of averaging. So you're looking at more of a, how much is that plot producing?
But the noise is in the canopy closure. So
yeah, once you get canopy closure.
It's going to affect your enclosure.
Right.
Enclosure,
right? Yeah. That's something we'll look into. Sure. Yes.
It looks like LIGAR is very reliable for measuring height, so that's one of your problems with the other types of measurements.
Yeah, I mean, we had, I know Dr. Professor, you presented some data that we had actually given him, and he had done a LIDAR scan, and we had done height measurements by graduate student, you know, or even student worker. And, he's like, well, it looks like your crop shrunk an inch over the growing season. We're like, well, you know, we came up with some, we put a little thought into it, and you're like, and they were getting, you know, heights at one point. And if you're in a field and you're looking at wheat or oats, whatever, you're going to have a lot of this, especially if you've got uneven ground. So you want to go in and maybe make five or six height estimations and then get the average of that. And that would correlate better well with what you did. But yeah, LIDAR is definitely the best tool for measuring height. Yes, sir.
Correlation of quantity is very good. But if you try to rank the 40 lines with two methods. What I'm saying is the first five,
mm-hmm,
are first 10. If they are within the first 10, which is two methods, I would be happy. But if the first becomes 40th in one, then it's even though 0.8 correlation is there.
Right,
but
it was
so right to see the rank.
We didn't do that yet. That might be something we can look into. Yes. How
expensive is LIDAR?
Oh, okay.
Is it a feasible approach for a 3 year?
Well, I would say for a university. No, from my understanding, it runs 30,000 to 40,000 for those scanners.
Cheap ones, I think. You can get one for $10.
Can you? Okay.
It's all done.
Yeah,
yeah.
It's cheap. It's only
a
penny per data form.
Yeah.
So you got that.
I look at that Forge officer, we've been asking for that for years. I don't see that false for years. and that's like, that's nowhere in the foreseeable future for us. But, you know, we hope some things like this can at least help breeders, you know, get a kind of a better idea of what kind of Forge potential their lives will have, you know. Yes.
So it seems like you just deal with forage, but what about if you let the plant go to full maturity to try to predict the actual seed yield and how different maturities could be affecting that or different levels of, you know, greenness?
Right. We haven't really checked that with yields yet. I know there's another student who's wanting to work on that in the within our program. He's wanted to let it go, you know, check NDVI readings throughout the growing season, and then check yield after that. But, I mean, I was looking in some of these publications about LIDAR, and they were looking at, this company out of, I think it was Australia, they're wanting to fix the LIDAR scanner in front of a combine for some reason. And their problem was that if the stands were too thin, the combine would kind of kick out a lot of the heads. Which I see that too in our fields, but they're wanting to get the density of that plot before they cut it. So they had these really nice LIDAR scans, and you could see the weak heads and everything as opposed to the ground level. So I wish I had a prepared slide, but there's a lot of things we could do with this technology. I'm just kind of getting into it now, out of desperation.
What you do is you do a LIDAR scan of the head and you count the pixels.
Yeah.
Hitting the head being correlated.
Right.
You should get a correlation.
Because I know one of the things, one of the things I was told is when we're getting the volume of that plot, you know, the most important thing is just set a uniform tube to measure each, or a uniform pixel, and you want to count the, it'll be the points in that pixel, and then you go, and you sum it up through that plot. So it's like, I think there's software out there, so I'm still kind of looking into it.
So I'm a little confused.
Yes, sir.
With the NDVI,
mm-hmm.
and there's correlation with yields, is the correlation with the yield potential of the genotype, or is it with stand density?
Do you want me to go back to a slide, or? Okay, so the question again is the correlation with yield, is it to do with yield density or?
Does it do with the stand density? Because it seems to me that once you get a true LAI, where you get there's no ground in shown,
right.
Then how does the reflectance tell you anything about yield?
Well, that's the.
You got one's dark green, one's light green.
Right, and that's the point I was trying to make earlier is like, if you could get to it before canopy closure, where you're still, you know, you'll look down, like when I do a visual forage reading, one of the things I look at is, okay, can you see any ground between that row? Once it gets to canopy closure, you're right, it's going to be a little harder to measure. But if we can get there before,
if I were a farmer, and you're going to tell me that variety A is higher yielding than variety B on these kinds of data. Are you confident that A is higher yielding than B? Or are you confident that in your plot, you have a better stand with variety A than you have with variety B?
You're right, because it could be genotype, because everything's treated the same. Nitrogen requirement, everything's going the same, plant data. So it could be a genotype environment, you know. Issue or
what plant height did you take? You had on a slide, I just don't remember.
Right.
You took multiple clippings.
Right.
Right? And so did you ever, in your design of your experiment, did canopy closure ever occur?
In some cases, yes. Because you'll have.
Those would have been the higher yielding
Not always. You'd be surprised. No? Okay. Because you'll have, depending on where that, like I say, if you got wheat, it's more erect growth, right?
Would there have been higher predicted yield?
That's something I could look into on that one.
Sure.
Your handheld MBVI was very highly correlated with everything.
Right.
So what's wrong with that? I mean, you are seeing your material and also you don't have to cut it.
Yeah, so I understand, but that's cost. I mean, I was only $500.
So what's wrong with that?
Nothing, it's just you're walking 1,000 bucks. I mean, basically,
yeah.
But you want to see your material also. So
you brought that point
the
before.
But ultimately, we want to use this technology to look at a lot of things inside and decide NDVI data. We want to look at actually different forms. We want to count the number of fillers. If you apply very close on a high precision, then even count the number of spikes that is high. We want to get to that point. So it's not only NDVI.
Why not just a robotic note taker instead of an airplane?
Well, I mean, I was thinking about
ride down the road.
So like, say, height and yield, you're like, well, if you have That's a good correlation to chart. So if you have
a very one of our statisticians
that we're. Oh Lord, yes, please take over.
So in simple terms, if X changes one unit, Y changes 0.8 units, that's correlation, that's Y. But does it make any difference how many units are involved? Is it always if I'm looking at yield at 1,000 pounds versus yield at 10,000 pounds?
Exactly. Well, if you're 95. Because actually, for the formation of corn B is high, right? You get three stars for significance. And that's what we try to tell people, that, you know, don't look at the significance, don't look at the stars. You know, that is significant at 1% or 5%. It doesn't make any sense. It needs to be high to take place to both high and significant. See, so it's not about significance, it's about the how high the correlation is and how close it is to 1. And also, it's not a cause and not a cause and effect relationship. It's asking how two variables are highly associated, okay, nothing else. But I like the idea of DB that you need to rank, you know, the top unit types, the lower unit types, and the same types.
It doesn't predict relationships.
No, it does not.
It's just a mathematical.
It is. It's an association. It's a measure of closeness or association. That is correlation.
It's not cause and effect.
No, it is not.
Both.
No.
So what if you find it correlation means the coefficient of determination is 16?
Understand they don't have a list of crashing if you're flying low. airplane's got to have a certain height to stay in the air.
Yeah, that was the issue. That's all I didn't get flights this year. I wasn't anywhere near
the airplane. Did they actually build an airplane this year?
Yeah, I mean, Dr. Torres group did.
Yeah.
Well, okay, so.
They blew off and you
jumped back? Well, these things are pretty little. Yeah. Basically, the way they have
it. I think, that's one, that's a joke, you know. Yeah, somebody's already been on the game.
So, even these, that one that you saw that Dr. Torres group has, it was, I think it was under $1,000 from Best Buy. But even with that, you could load a flight plan. And it has almost like an autopilot. So the guy would take off, and he would just kind of step back, and it would go, it would do its flight path, right? And then he would tell it to come back and land. So I think with that one, it got up there, and it started doing it, and then it had a better idea on its own. It took off. Yeah, it just took off. So they kind of have a mind of their own sometimes. But the two flights over there were really, really done well. And,
T-shirt.
Very big T-shirt.
Please.
Very big T-shirt.
Very big T-shirt.